Hi, this is Julie. If the kind of conversations you're finding here on the podcast resonate with you, I'd love for you to join a growing community in the private Mother's Quest Facebook group. You'll get more personal reflections from me, invitations to our free weekly Epic Life check-ins, and the opportunity to meet some amazing like-minded mothers on a quest. Visit mothersquest.com/community to join. Hi, and welcome to Mother's Quest, a podcast for moms like me ready to live our own truly epic life. I'm Julie Neal, a life and leadership coach, community builder, writer, and mom to two high-energy boys who challenge me to grow into my best
mom!
Self.
Mom!
I'll be right there.
Where was I?
In the months leading up to a big milestone birthday, I decided it was time to stop sidelining my dreams and realize that I'm the hero of my own journey. I knew I didn't want to do it alone, so I created this podcast to learn from other moms on their own quest, so their words of wisdom and lessons learned could help light the way for mine. I created this podcast for myself. Come along with me, and you'll find some treasures of your own. Hello, and welcome to episode number 38 of the Mother's Quest podcast with someone who even my children were excited I was interviewing, best-selling, award-winning children's recording artist, Lori Berkner. Widely recognized as the uncrowned queen of children's music, Lori's albums, released on her own label, Two Tomatoes, have been bestsellers beloved by children and adults alike. Her debut DVD, which went quadruple platinum, was the first ever indie children's music DVD to enter Billboard's top music video chart at number one. Lori's 12th album, Lori Berkner Dance Remixes, was released in September 2017. A longtime fixture on TV's Nick Jr. and Sprout channels, Lori's music videos now appear regularly on NBC Universal's Universal Kids channel. And she's ventured into new creative endeavors, writing the music and lyrics for three off-Broadway children's musicals produced by New York City Children's Theater, and publishing a series of Simon & Schuster books for young readers, including Pillowland, which has become my son Jacob's story and song of choice at bedtime. Lori's music bridges a divide between parents and their children and invites connection, joy, and meaning. When I reached out to ask the mothers of my community who else loved Lori and why, I was flooded with responses. But this story from my friend Denise Barreto of Relationships Matter Now really touched me, and I asked Denise if she would dedicate the episode. Here she is with her dedication.
My name is Denise Barreto, and I'm the founder and managing partner of Relationships Matter Now. I'm delighted to dedicate this episode of Mother's Quest, the podcast, to one mom whose life and recent passing has impacted me greatly, Dr. Roslyn Tenniel Truss Linder. Dr. Roz, as she was affectionately known through education circles in the United States and the Caribbean, was a lion of a woman and a mama force to be reckoned with. Like all of us, she struggled to strike the best work-life integration and build healthy patterns for her family. Something we shared in common was a struggle with family and even the word family. Lori Berkner actually helped both Roz and I to reconcile family. My family, F-A-M-I-L-Y, that song, that iconic song that could be heard playing throughout my children's childhood years ago, was recently dusted off and shared with Roz in 2017, what we now know was her last year on Earth. It helped us both to family each other and to really recalibrate who is family and how we family. Yes, I made family a verb. As mothers and women, it's critical for us to be very intentional with our families to ensure that all the people we family are loved, accepted, seen, and heard. In today's America, this is more important than ever. Take a moment in honor of today's guest and my special friend, Dr. Roz, and look at How You Family.
Thank you for this beautiful dedication, Denise. I loved hearing your reflection of your dear friend, Dr. Roz, her incredible qualities as a lion of a woman, and how Lori's music connected you both during some difficult times. Stories of impact beyond the music that Lori's songs provide were one of the most compelling parts of our conversation, as Lori shared feedback she's received from families whose children have cancer and listen to her music for comfort in the hospital, or whose children have autism and their first words were the names of Lori's songs. For her, bringing opportunities for connection and making space for creative expression is her true mission and has begun to take many new forms. I was fascinated to learn about the unplanned path that brought her from preschool teacher to children's musician and how the tenets that inform her music curriculum that she's created to stop talking and put it in the music, to let children express themselves in their own voice, and to follow children's rhythm and leadership are all powerful metaphors for parenthood and life. I loved every single moment of this conversation, but especially the end, where Lori recounts a recent epic snapshot moment with her own daughter, and then closed us out with her guitar in hand, singing my favorite song of hers, Moon, Moon, Moon. I felt so enriched by this conversation, and following Lori's guidance, I'm committed to creating more space for emotion, connection, play, and music with my children. But there's also something else. The day after I recorded this episode, I took in the power of the lunar eclipse and the rare blue moon, sending an email to Lori to note the synchronicity of it all. I was struck again this week to learn that as I released this episode, Dr. Roz would have been celebrating her 42nd birthday. So I also leave this experience with renewed faith in ripple effects beyond what we can at first imagine, and an honor for the rhythm in our lives if we make the space to listen. I'm Julie Neal, and this is Mother's Quest. Lori Berkner, welcome to the Mother's Quest podcast. This is so much fun and so exciting to have you on.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
I'd like to say a few words about why I'm bringing a guest on at the beginning. And I'll tell you a little bit of like where the seed got planted. My kids and I love your music. I have two boys, one who's almost 14 now. And so we don't listen to your music anymore. But when he was younger, in the Buzz Buzz and Victor Vito days, we would rock out to your music all the time. And now I have a five-year-old, and he and I like to have some dance parties. We were running around the house, the song Let's Go Swimming. And all of a sudden, I just had this moment of like, oh my God, Lori Berkner, she's so fantastic. I would love to have her on the podcast. And I stopped, I pressed pause on the YouTube video we were listening to, and I ran to my computer and found the contact and sent that message out. And told Jake, maybe Lori will come on the podcast. And sure enough, within like 24 hours, your Elizabeth, I don't know if she's your assistant or your project manager.
She's my publicist.
Your publicist. She got back to me and said that you would be interested. So I'm so glad that I was in the midst of the dance party in that moment, had that inspiration and acted on it. I am looking for more music and play in my life and with my children this year. It's one of my resolutions, and I can't imagine a better guide for that than you.
Thank you. I'm very flattered. I'm glad that you made that message happen.
So the first question that I ask every guest at the beginning of the podcast is for you to tell me a little bit about your childhood and the impact that your own mother has had in shaping who you are today.
When I think about what I do today, there are a couple of big sides. You know, there's me as a musician, but I also run my own business. So the thing that my mom helped shape in me a lot was the feeling that I could do something like that. She was always a working mom. She actually, hours were often much more than my father's. She traveled a lot, and her career was really important to her. And that was actually something that I didn't always like when I was a kid, because it took her away, which I really felt resentful of sometimes, mm-hmm. which also is something that informs how I feel like I try to be now as a parent who is a very working parent, but I have much more control over my schedule than she did because I work for myself. So I think a lot about how much time am I spending doing my work? How much time am I spending away from my family? And how much time can I spend with them? And what do I do when I spend time with them? And remembering that also, even if I've been away, that when I come home, things don't have to center around my needs. Like, I can come home and make a choice to try to fit into what's happening here, rather than feeling like, hey, I was away, now you should pay attention to me, you know, which I think is like an impulse that I sometimes feel. So I just try to remember a lot, you know, how that was sometimes hard for me when I was a kid. But at the same time, I also appreciate that I had a role model of a strong mother who was took very seriously being somebody who was in the workforce and doing something that she loved.
What was the kind of work that she did?
Well, she started out in library science and she ended up going into marketing for publishing companies. So she worked with books her whole life and kind of getting them out to other people.
So it's interesting. There's that thread of communication and reaching people with a message that sounds like it also transferred to you.
Yeah, I think so. She's always been really interested in new things. Like, if I want to know about like a cool app, I should call my mom. She's in her 70s.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So she's very interested in like discovering new things. That's another great thing that she modeled for me.
That's so fantastic. I'm definitely noticing, you know, threads of other conversations I've had with women on the podcast whose mothers have also worked and what that example was for them in terms of a woman, even maybe before there were as many opportunities available, showing that they could be making a difference and pursuing a career while having a family. But at the same time, this desire to have more control and more ability to be home with your children, I really relate and also have heard this theme about trying to find this way of blending both of those things.
Yeah. And I guess I just wanted to add, she's not a musician particularly, but she was always very supportive of my music, of my interest in acting, singing, performing, writing, anything artistic. She never saw herself that way, but I think it was fun and exciting for her to see me that way. So she might say, well, music, you might love it and maybe you should think of a backup plan, but if you want some help, I'll help you do that first. You know, like, I think she was a little bit afraid sometimes when I said, oh, I'm going to do music as my life, which actually originally I never thought I would do something like that. But when I finally made that decision, I think she was a little nervous, but definitely fully supportive. So I didn't feel like I was doing something wrong by choosing like not a quote safe kind of a job. And I felt clear that I was willing to take whatever risks at that time in my life. So it felt really good to know that I had that support.
Well, I think this is a great segue into being able to learn a little bit more about your life path. What brought you to doing this work that you do, where you are this musician and a successful entrepreneur? Tell me a little bit about when you look at the sort of story of your life up till this point, how would you describe what you've been on a quest for? And how did you arrive at this point in your life story?
The thing that's always been really important and interesting to me, and what feels fulfilling and is part of the mission statement of my business, is creativity, is for me to give myself a space for myself to create. But essentially, it's basically to create things that help other people connect and feel. And I don't even have a mission statement about making music particularly, or working with kids particularly. I think those are just two things that I love. And over the years, I've found that people really respond to when I make things in those worlds. So I followed it. But really, my deepest quest is to really continue to make things, to allow what's inside of myself come outside and hopefully have that be something that affects other people in a positive way.
I love that. And I love how it allows for your path to take lots of different turns. Like, I noticed that now you have some storybooks and that you're writing children's musicals. And, you know, it just seems like as long as you're staying true to this impulse about creativity and connecting with people through that, there's so many different places it can take you.
Yeah, it's true. And that's actually, this really important to me, because I feel like one of the reasons that I like what I do is because I can choose, you know, how to create things, how to spend my time a lot of the time, and how I want to express myself. And, you know, it's been really important to be able to have that be flexible.
I have this community of amazing mothers on a quest. And every now and then before an interview, I'll let them know who's coming up and ask them questions. So I had shared that I was interviewing you, and I asked people to share what their favorite songs were or memories or things that they had, questions they may have for you. First of all, I was blown away just by how many people had the same experience I did of just such fond memories of sharing your music with their children, and they all shared their favorite songs. One friend of mine actually also goes to preschools and teaches kids sign language, and so she uses your songs to teach them in signing. She also mentioned that her grandmother and your grandmother, I guess, lived across the hall in Florida, and she used to get her CDs from her grandmother. Another friend talked about how, you know, she has biracial children and also went through a divorce, and your song about family and just the inclusivity of it, including the images of families that are in the video, how that was such value to her and her kids. And then one person said, how did Lori come down this path? Like, how did she end up creating children's music in this way? So I'd love to hear a little bit about what was the path that brought you to doing this work.
Well, I was trying to be a rock star. When I say that, I mean I could write music and that people would listen. I think I was very afraid of that for a long time. I mean, I wasn't so old, but I was maybe 19 or something, I think, when I wrote my first song. It wasn't something that I did as a kid, really. And I guess I wanted to be able to write music that kind of did what my mission statement says, which is that, like, had an effect on them. Because I would go and see other musicians and I would get chills and I would have all these feelings and I would leave with different ideas about my life. And I felt like, oh, that's what I want to do. I want to make music that gives all of that to other people and opens it up in them. I mean, it's mostly, I'm not really giving anybody anything, you know, it's all inside of them. But I think it sometimes can be the thing that opens the door to noticing that those things inside yourself, right? When you hear a song that might, like, trigger a memory or bring up a feeling or inspire a connection, something like that. So all of those things made me want to write. I was in some bands. I had a band that I was writing my own music for, called Red Onion at the time. You'll see through this interview if we talk about the names of things that I like to name things after food.
It's Two Tomatoes.
Yeah, that's my record label. Yeah. And the touring company is also Two Tomatoes Touring. So in the meantime, had graduated from college. I had been playing in bands in school and kind of really started to explore writing and playing with other people, and found out that really quickly that it takes a lot of people to fill a rock club. Mm-hmm. And I would, you know, tap into all my friends, and eventually I ended up joining an all-female cover band, which was the band where I made some money instead of losing money trying to be a musician. And in the meantime, I also got a job as a preschool music teacher, moved to New York City to try to, you know, be a musician. I was playing in coffee houses, and my downstairs neighbor was a movement teacher, and I used to babysit for her daughter. She was a movement teacher for preschoolers and at Rockefeller University on the East Side, and said, you know, we're losing our music teacher of 10 years there, and they're looking for someone, honestly, who's cheap and, like, young and eager, and you should apply for the job. So I did, and they gave it to me, which I'm very grateful for. I'm not really sure why they did, because I had no idea what I was doing. And I really, really struggled. I didn't know how to talk to the kids. I really didn't know how to manage a classroom. And so I went and I actually watched my predecessor. Her name is Ruth Alperson. She was a Dalcroze Eurythmic trained teacher, and Dalcroze Eurythmics is sort of is a body-based music teaching curriculum. So I watched that and I thought about that. I ended up taking a class in it because I was inspired by her. And I said, how do you manage the kids? They do everything you say. They don't like run around and not pay attention to you like they do with me. And she was like, oh, just stop talking. Ooh. Put it in the music, you know? And I thought, okay, great. So I went back and I looked for songs that did that. And I had a really hard time finding them. And also there was like no Spotify or Google or anything. I had to go to the library and like listen to song after song on record players and CDs. And I ended up realizing if I just make up the songs, I could actually put into the song what I want them to do. And that was really the turning point for me, was, you know, finally just kind of getting so frustrated and fed up. And one of the first songs I wrote was We Are the Dinosaurs. And it was basically one day in the class, it was in my music room, and I was sitting there with the kids and they just were giving me the like, oh, I hate that song. I don't want to sing that one. Every song that I tried that I had, you know, diligently researched and learned and found. And I finally just said, well, what do you guys want to sing about? And this one kid yelled, dinosaurs. And then they all went, yeah, dinosaurs. I was like, great, stand up. And I thought, okay, dinosaurs, big marching. Let's march. Minor key, dum, 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 like the ants go marching. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, so I just started
creating.
Totally. And that's a way that I actually work really well, is under some pressure and trying to do things kind of spontaneous, at least in terms of music, I work well that way. So for me, it was a great situation where I just started doing it and they loved it. And then the next time I saw them a couple days later, I think I saw each class twice a week. They came back in and said, sing that dinosaur song again. And I thought, oh my God, I don't remember it at all. But I remembered marching and a minor key. And I just started playing it again. And over time, you know, I would notice things like, oh, they're getting really wild. Let's stop and eat our food on the ground. Yeah. Then they would do it, you know, because they were dinosaurs doing it. And that's what made it fun. So I started to really learn a lot about that as I watched them. And, you know, I tried different things and some things didn't work and some things really did. But mostly that Say It With The Music, that was a huge, huge help to me.
Wow. So first of all, I'm so grateful to know this backstory. It brings so much meaning to the work that you do now. And I'm thinking about, we often talk on the podcast about the power of metaphor. I was just struck by, like, I think my jaw literally dropped when you said you learned, or she gave you that advice to just stop talking. And I'm thinking, wow, what just like a great metaphor for parenting in general. Mm-hmm. To just, you know, stop talking or put it in music or something else that the kids can embody. And also now that you say that, I'm thinking about the song that my son and I love to do, where like all of a sudden we're running crazy and then we're like pretending to sleep. And what a great metaphor that is too, for noticing the rhythm in life and giving yourself the chance to slow down when you need to, and then, you know, speed up when you've been resting. Really great.
That's everything. I mean, to me, that's everything. I'm not doing this teaching right now anymore, but I actually developed an entire teacher training program called The Music in Me in the last few years. And I wrote a 50-page philosophy book of all the things that I think about when I'm writing music and what I saw when I was working directly with the kids and teaching in a classroom setting. And Sing It, Don't Say It. That's like one of the main tenets, right? And the whole idea of understanding the rhythm both of yourself, you with the kids, each kid individually, and each song, and each class. Like every single thing has a rhythm. And if you follow it, then that brings out the best of everything. And a lot of that has to do with following rhythm the way that we breathe, the way that we walk, right? Sort of, there's a rhythm to our walking. There's a rhythm to your heartbeat. There's a rhythm to the in and the out, the beating and the pause, you know, walking and taking a rest. And we sleep, we get up, like we all have to do that. And nature is like that. And I feel like if that comes out in a song, it's an immediate connection to any human, you know, and that's one of the things that I try to look for when I'm writing is how do I find that rhythm in the song? How can I bring it out so the kids also feel a really natural and familiar connection to themselves when they're singing it?
I love this. I can tell this is going to be one of those episodes where I'm going to rewind to exactly this part. You hear it a few times, so it really sinks in. This is a great segue, actually, to the first of four epic guideposts that are part of the framework for Mother's Quest. Just to give you a little bit more background, essentially, when I created Mother's Quest, I was trying to figure out what is this thing that I'm after in my own life and that I want to help bring to other mothers. And it really is this idea of living an epic life, and it's living your epic life. So we each have our own experience and understanding of what would make our own lives meaningful. So it's not somebody else's picture of what an epic life is, but what really matters to each of us. And this idea of kind of following your own heroine's journey, where you answer your call and you say yes, you don't let fear stop you, and you really live your life to the fullest. So it captures, first of all, that connotation of being on this journey. But also then I wanted to see if I could capture the things as a mother that I feel like I'm always trying to pay attention to or learn about or improve in order to live a more epic life. So it came out one night sitting at the kitchen table with a pen and a napkin where I was like, okay, epic, this is what it is. Does it also stand for something? And it really did just pour out these four, what I call guideposts in this time of my life while I'm raising my children. And the first one, E, stands for engaged. And it's about being mindfully engaged with our children. So I'd love to hear, first of all, who you're a mom to. You know, I think you've started to move in this direction already, but if you were to really encapsulate what you've learned about how to, you know, mindfully engage with your child, what that lesson has been.
Well, it's interesting because I think it has changed a lot over the course of her life. I have one daughter, she's 13 now. Just to put it in context, I started writing kids' music probably, let's see, mid-90s. So anyway, about 10 years before she was born. Mm. So about half of my career was pre being a parent, and now it's starting to become a little more than half that is post. And it was interesting because before I had her, I wasn't sure if I wanted kids. I was with kids all the time. I loved that, but I also loved having a little bit of space that wasn't with kids, you know, when I finished my day. So when I did end up becoming a parent, I was shocked at how much I just wanted to spend all my time with her. You know, really, it was a very different feeling, and I learned a lot in that. As far as the question of being mindful with her, when I'm with her, I think a lot actually about how I manage my own feelings around her. Mm-hmm. One thing would be like getting angry when she does something and my response is that I feel angry. One thing that I know I have tried to be aware of for a whole life, because I remember this happening from when she was a toddler and now she's a teen, is to try to warn her and myself that I'm starting to have these feelings before I act them out. So that's one big thing that I feel like is something I'm always working on and trying to be aware of. And it's funny because when she was little, I think I was better at it. And I think I would have thought, well, I would get better at it as she's been around longer. But I feel like I expect her now to be more responsible. So when she does things that I think aren't or I feel upset about, I just have this very quick, you know, like I get angry. And I feel like I find out sometimes afterwards if I've just kind of started yelling at her that she might have had a different experience of that moment, and that's why she did the thing that she did, and or that there was some other circumstance that was something I didn't know about beforehand, or there was something that I did that like I wasn't even conscious of, you know, that started the whole chain of events. So I found that it helps so much when I feel that starting to rise, like, you know what, I'm starting to get really angry right now and I don't want to start yelling at you. So like, what's really going on? And that helps a lot in our communication. And it even used to really help when she was really small, because it gave her a space to talk to me and So I'm not sure if that's exactly what you're asking, but that's kind of what came to mind first when you asked that question.
Yeah. I love the idea of just kind of creating space between the emotion that you are noticing is rising and, yes. and the reaction. What I also hear you saying is bringing a certain amount of curiosity to your interaction with your child and creating space again to really hear what was their experience or how were they seeing what took place so you understand yeah. better.
Yeah. And I mean, other things that come to mind when you ask that question are just literally making time for her to be able to share things where it's not pressured. A lot of times it's when she's in bed or getting ready for bed, and that's kind of been her whole life. So even now as a teen, like there's something very intimate about that time that seems to allow her to open up. So that means like remembering, like, let's make sure that she's getting in bed early enough that this doesn't go on till midnight, mm-hmm. you know, and that I don't feel stressed out, that I feel like open and ready for her to share things with me, or making time in the evenings. We actually have sort of built into our evenings now post-homework, before bed, time, no screens, just like time where we share things with each other or we do music. It took a long time to actually instigate that. Yeah, whatever the word is, but like to make that happen. And it just like, it's hard that, you know, as I've noticed, I don't know if this is particular to New York, but like, our kids are doing a lot of things, and then we all have, I think, a lot of people have very busy lives, and it can be easy to forget that sometimes there just needs to actually be some time right. to spend with each other, you know, even if, and we always sit down to dinner together, but she sometimes will eat really fast and then leap up to go finish her homework. So we had to actually say like, hey, we're going to have some time before you go to bed where we're all just talking, or now it's playing music for a long time. That wasn't something mm-hmm. that she wanted to do, you know, or playing a game, even something, yeah. something that we're sharing that time together and interacting with each other.
I love that. Yeah. Another thing I'm on a quest for is managing everybody in our family's connection to screens and trying to figure out, you know, what do we need to do in terms of changing things structurally?
Yeah.
So that we're not always just, you know, on the computer or, you know, on the phone. So I love that idea of making some sacred time before bed where you're just doing things together. Well, the next guidepost, P, stands for passionate and purposeful. And that's about making a difference in the world beyond our family. You've talked some about this already, but I'd love to hear, what do you feel like you've learned about this guidepost that you're, you know, continuing to evolve for yourself in terms of how you make a difference?
I think the thing that I said at the beginning, where my goal has always been to be able to be creative, what I've noticed is by doing that, actually sharing what I create seems to be something that allows other people to actually have all the things that I wanted. Like to sometimes it gives them a space to be more connected. It creates memories for their families. There's an expression of love that happens when music is shared that I think is really bonding, and that happens a lot for parents and kids together when they listen to my music. So, you know, just on a really basic level, one of the things that I learned was that actually when we create things, we're giving a gift for someone else to be able to hear that and interpret it and internalize it and then integrate it into their own lives in a way that helps them grow or feel good or connect or just feel anything. I think that's a very powerful thing to remember, and that I sometimes have to remind myself that just actually taking all my energy and pouring it into creating new songs that have a meaning for me, that seems to be something that I'm giving to other people. So I love being conscious of that, because I think sometimes I think, well, all I do is write music. Like, what is that? You know, and I have to remind myself, this is actually a gift. It's okay to think of it that way. I think there's a part of me that feels like, oh, well, that's very, it's too self-aggrandizing. But I think that's how I feel when I hear music that means something to me from other people. So yeah. I'm trying to remember that more and accept it and own it, I guess is maybe more what I mean. So there's that piece of it, because I do feel really passionate about what I'm writing and thinking about the families and the kids that I'm hoping to reach. And just an aside for that, one of the ways that I do that a lot is I think a lot about singing in a child's voice. When I'm singing a song and I'm having a concert and I look out and I see kids singing those words, they're singing things that have meaning for them. They're not singing words that I'm singing as an adult at them that has meaning for me as an adult so much. And that is something I think about a lot. And I really want the music to be meaningful for them to feel like it's their music. That's one big piece of that. The other thing that I've learned from the feedback that I get from families is that there seems to be even a deeper experience with my music that I can pay attention to, which is using it when families have to go through difficult times, like when their child is hospitalized, or especially kids who are struggling with a lot of, you know, heart defects, cancer, like all kinds of things that put them into a situation that's very unlike home. And the music is a connector for them. It's a way to feel like there's something familiar and joyful, and that has a sense of love in it that they're sharing with their families, even if they're not home and they're maybe going through something that's difficult. Same thing, families of kids with all different kinds of special needs. The music seems to be something that allows kids to express themselves. And I think that makes it something that they want to sing. So their kids with autism, the first words they ever spoke were like the name of one of my songs or something to say, I want you to play that song for me. You know, like there's a desire behind it. So I feel like knowing that and understanding that there's something in what I'm making that isn't particularly, it's not intentional for that absolute purpose, specific purpose, but it is that I'm trying to connect to kids and create music that they feel this ownership over. It has that result. And it feels really important to keep doing it and keep making music that's like that for them, because that means that then these families and kids have those experiences even more. And, you know, the more that I can do to support families in that way, that's what I feel like is a really important purpose for me to have. And that feels like I'm actually fulfilling something that the music can do that's a higher purpose than just, you know, my own desire for being creative.
Yeah. Wow. That's so powerful. I have two boys who are called differently wired, and music for my older son, absolutely, when he was younger in particular, it was really like a gateway for him. And it's been interesting to see how it, you know, now he plays the guitar and sings, and he was just in School of Rock. You know, it really is an incredible way to build confidence and connect. And I agree with you, the power of what you're doing has many ripple effects that you might not notice from the first, you know, just putting out the song. The next guidepost, I, stands for invested in yourself. This is about, you know, self-care and nurturing the things that fulfill and fill you, you know, continuing your own growth and learning. What have you found are the things that you do to invest in yourself?
I've just sighed because I feel like I think about this every day and how difficult it is to find enough time to do all the things that I would like to do to take care of myself and of everything, you know. So of course we're always making choices. I actually have a framed writing near my bed that I wrote out. Like one of the main things on it is I make choices. I can't actually have everything that I want, but I make choices from my heart and I do the best that I can, you know? And so that's like, in an ideal world, the things that I try to do a lot of and that I feel are super important are exercising, which I do actually do pretty much every day. And I can't do my shows if I don't do that. I literally, like, I don't know how I would do them. You know, I spend an hour to an hour and a half singing and running and jumping and lying down on stage. And it's a fantastically physical experience. And I have to be able to sing well through it, as well as I'm actually playing guitar while that's happening.
Oh my goodness.
The singing, like the guitar playing, that's practicing, which is another thing that's on my list besides exercising. Practicing with my voice, it is easier to forget that I need to vocalize, which is my vocal practice. And it's pretty much the same as exercising. Like if I don't vocalize regularly, I would like to be doing it every day. I don't do it every single day. But if I don't do it regularly, I can't jump and sing in tune. You know, I can't get all the sounds that I want. It's so specifically related to that. Like if I haven't warmed up, if I haven't been vocalizing, you know, regularly before a show, it's just like, I'll do the show and realize, I don't know how much people can tell the difference. Probably nothing compared to what I notice, but it is really super important. So that's the third thing. I meditate. Mostly I find that I do it during the week because I have a little bit more of a regular schedule when I have shows on the weekend or we're doing stuff as a family. It's harder. But Brian, actually my husband, he instigated that with me. I had been kind of doing it, trying mindfulness meditation on and off for years. And he is now a therapist after having been my bass player for a while. He went back to school for that and he's very interested actually in how mindfulness is related to therapy. And so he really like pushed us doing that together. And I've been very grateful because that also, it feels good. I feel like I need to do more of it. It's everything. I need to do more of eating well and getting outside. I don't know. I feel like I could go on and on. But those are some of the big things. I literally, like, I make a to-do list before I go to bed in a notebook. And every day it says the same thing because I'm a very easily distracted person. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't remember that when I get up, I want to take my supplements, work out, meditate, make Lucy's lunch. But, like, I have, like, five things like that every single morning. And I write the same thing down every night. And if I don't do it, I will honestly forget one or two of them the next day.
Yeah, it is so easy to get distracted and really easy to have the caring for yourself be the first thing that goes.
Yeah.
Well, you started to talk about your husband, Brian, and the last guidepost, C, stands for connected. And it's about being in community while you're on your journey. Where are the places where you have found connection and community?
Well, I mean, certainly my family. I feel like the three of us are a very strong unit, and I feel grateful for that. It's funny. I feel like my strongest community is all the people I come in contact with through my work. I have a really strong team of people. Actually, one person in California, that's my publicist who you were in touch with, my manager and booking person who's in Colorado, and we meet once a week just to talk about everything that's kind of happening in my business and in the music world. And then I have people in my office who work for me and with me. And that is like an incredible support place for me. The women in my office, like I ask them to meet with me regularly just to have me say, here's a song I'm working on so that I finish it. You know, like here's the story I'm working on right now. Like, how does it make you feel? You know, it's like just to have almost like a support group. And outside of that, the other person that I've actually been using as a strong supporter these days that we're sort of doing it for each other is my brother, who lives out in California and is also has his own business. He's a wonderful musician. His business is not in music, but we talk once a week and we set goals for ourselves and then kind of follow up with each other and see how we're doing. Actually, he's one of the reasons that now I write every night before I go to bed. I felt like I would always leave that kind of loosey-goosey and like, oh, I write when I feel like it or when I have a deadline. And I have just notebook after notebook and I look back and I realize like, oh, that's kind of a song already. And there's so many things I don't even remember because I'm tired and I just do it. I go to bed, but there's so much in there. So that's been also a really wonderful connector for me.
So great. We're getting close to the end of the interview. In a moment, I want to ask you to give me a challenge. But before we do that, one of my most favorite questions to ask is about what I call an epic snapshot moment. I think we all have these moments in our life when we feel like what we're experiencing is like everything that matters most to us. And it almost feels like time slows down and you recall back, you know, where you were and what was happening in that moment in an instant. I'm curious, when you look at your life, the themes that we've been discussing today, is there a particular epic snapshot moment that comes up for you?
It made me think of something that happened a week ago. Which I don't know if it's, I mean, mostly because I think a lot of what we've been talking about has been evolving over time. So right now, you know, when I was talking about taking that space before Lucy goes to bed in the evening to be together, she's someone who has kind of, for a long time, I feel like she sort of avoided identifying herself as a musician or a singer in any way because of my job, and also that Brian is also a fantastic musician and he likes to play around the house and stuff. And I think maybe there was some, a little bit of pressure there for her. So it's been fantastic that, first of all, she secretly decided she wanted to start playing the drums and told the babysitter when she was younger. And so she started doing that. And then she doesn't really like to practice in front of us. And then last year, she asked for a ukulele for her birthday. And she started playing in front of us and asking for help. And she plays pretty amazingly already. And that's one of the things that we do in the evening. So when we were, I don't know when it was, a week or two ago, we had all gone to see The Greatest Showman. She got really interested in one of the songs, so, or a lot of the songs actually, but she specifically wanted to play this song, Tightrope. And so we had all kind of over some days figured out those chords together, and it was evening. She had finished her homework. Dinner was over. We said, okay, we're going to do our hour together. What do you want to do? And she said, I want to play Tightrope. And she pulled out her ukulele, and it was like she's leading us in doing something musical together, not me, her musician mom, not her dad, who like is always the one who, like, I don't even pull out the guitar at home very much. Like, he's the one who does. And she's like, I want to play this song. And we played it through our speakers. And while we were playing, I realized I was learning about like different chord structures and ways of finger picking. And I was watching her doing things on the ukulele that were different voicings than what I'm used to on the guitar. And so I was both like enjoying that we were actually doing something together that she was leading us in and had a lot of excitement and passion for that had to do with music. And I was also learning something, which I feel like that's another task of mine and something that I really want for myself is like, keep learning about music, keep growing. That's how I can continue to be creative, right? So I felt like all of these things were coming together and the three of us were sharing, you know, even just a few minutes of that song, but we all had our way of experiencing the music together that felt good for all of us. Like Brian was on his electric and it just was, I don't know, it felt so wonderful. And I knew that we weren't forcing her to be doing something with us that she didn't want to be doing, you know, just to get her off a screen or, you know, it was like everybody wanted to be doing the same thing. And yet we were able to do it together and we could play off each other too. I mean, that's one of the beautiful things about music is you sing a word and someone can sing it back to you. You can play instrument at the same time, but have your sound be blending with the other person's sound. You know, there's just so much the actual vibrations of the music at that time. Like we're all experiencing them together. There's so much in it. So it just felt wonderful and so fulfilling to me. And I also felt like, wow, I finally feel like the thing I've been wanting to do for everybody else when I write my music, which is like create music that allows people to bond and feel love between, you know, themselves and their parents, the kids and their parents, and the other way. Like, we were doing that right then. Like, I felt how much I loved her. We were sharing music together. I didn't have to write that song for that to happen. You know, we just had to make the space for it. And that was one of those moments.
Yes. I'm teary hearing about it.
Oh.
Well, I feel like it's a perfect segue into the challenge. Because I would love, you know, I mentioned at the beginning, but I would love to create more space for me and my family to connect and to do it through music and play. What is a challenge you could offer me? And then anyone who wants to say yes as well, who's listening, to bring that into our life?
I think this might kind of incorporate what you're talking about. Something that I think is a really cool challenge generally, which I challenge myself to do a lot and other people have said is helpful to them, is when you're in a situation with your child or children and you're doing something, maybe just like a regular old everyday something, or maybe it's something boring or it's something that's hard, like something where you wouldn't think of music. Like, maybe just try turning it into a song. Yeah. Like, you know, just the sing it, don't say it, you know? An example would be, like, I remember when she was really little, we'd be walking down the street. We'd have to get from one place to another. And, like, sometimes walking a far distance was hard. You know, it was long. She was tired. She was little. She'd rather be in a stroller or be carried or something. So we would, like, use the rhythm of our feet. And I would just make up, like, we're walking, we're jumping over the crack, whatever. There's a piece of gum on the floor. You know? And you don't even, if you feel comfortable singing and making up something, like, you know, we're going to the dentist or whatever it is. Yeah. Like, I think that's even more, it's more powerful. And it can be something that you'll remember and then do again the next time. Yeah. But even just turning something that you're doing into a rhythmic, playful thing. It can be, and if you don't feel comfortable with words, it can be a rhythm tapping on the table as you pass something for dinner. You know, just finding a way to incorporate your own sense of internal rhythm into music with your kids in a situation where you might not usually do that. I think that's a really wonderful way to also give them a space to create it with you. Like, you might start it, but then let them finish it. Let them respond to you. Let them start the next part of it. And that might be a way to incorporate all those things that we're talking about, and as well as bringing the playfulness in, like you were saying, is something you want to do more of.
Yes, I love it. I have done that before, but I love the idea of consciously creating more opportunity for that, and also involving, you know, most likely be more relevant with my 5-year-old, but letting him join in and complete it and lead the way with it.
Mm-hmm.
So that'll be a lot of fun. I will report back to you and let you know how that goes.
Great.
Well, so we're at the end of our conversation, and I like to end with an opportunity for both of us just to identify what we're taking away from this conversation. So I think one of my biggest takeaways from this conversation, this gift of getting to hear what's underneath all of your music, is the power of rhythm. That seems to be a thread that came through so many of the guideposts, really particularly with children, allowing them to find their rhythm, creating opportunities for them to use their voice and for music to be their own expression, and bringing that more thoughtfully and more often into our life. I'm also really struck by the way that you live your purpose around creativity. You know, first and foremost, creating something that feels meaningful to you. But then also, there's a way in which you start there, but then you release expectation about the ways in which that's going to impact others. And then I loved hearing about all of the things that you didn't imagine were possible because you created from that place. First for yourself, but then also with this tremendous respect for children. So I'm going to carry those lessons about creativity, impact, and rhythm into my life. Thank you for all those gifts.
Yeah, that's actually very helpful just to hear you reflect back to me, because I don't always think about all those things in that way.
Yeah. And what do you feel like is the biggest takeaway for you from slowing down and having this conversation?
I think it was really noticing that idea of making space. I didn't think about that before we were talking, but I heard myself saying it over and over again while we were talking. And I realized, I mean, I struggle with that so much because I feel like every day is so full and I can't ever, there are never enough hours and I never get enough sleep. And at the same time, I do have to make choices, right? It's a fantastic reminder that making the choice to make space for my relationship with my daughter and my husband, it's just hugely important. And it's not just for me, it's for, particularly as a parent, it's for her to be able to have time to connect with us and to also maybe discover some things in herself that she wants to share. You know, all of those things, I feel like I won't get them if there isn't space for her to do that. And the cliche of how fast they grow up, we're living it, right? So it's only a cliche because it really feels like that. And I feel like this time is so precious because in a few years, she won't even be living in the same house as me anymore. So I really treasure getting to spend time with her in whatever way she's willing to share herself with me. So reminding myself that actually making time for that is really, really important. That's something I will definitely take away from this.
Fantastic. As you were talking, I often have the title of the episode come to me before the conversation's over. And I'm just thinking, you know, making space and finding rhythm.
Nice.
The two themes that are really landing for me right now. So before we go, Lori, I was thinking this morning that I would just love to hear you sing the first part of our favorite song that my children and I sing together. Even today, even with my 13-year-old, if we see a full moon, you know, sometimes we get out of the car and stop and point up to it and sing this song. So it would be an epic snapshot moment just to be able to hear you singing this live, and it will close out our conversation.
I would love to.
Moon, 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 shining bright. Moon, 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 my night light.
Chick, turn it on.
Moon, 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 I can see. Moon, 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 you're taking care of me.
Thank you, Lori.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much for coming along with me on this episode of the Mother's Quest podcast. I hope this conversation sparked something that will help you live your epic life. If you'd like to get show notes and learn more about the Mother's Quest community, head over to motherquest.com. And while you're there, I would love it if you would follow the prompts to subscribe, leave a review, and help us spread the word. I want to end with some words to help light the way on your quest. Seize the day. Love your people. Honor your gifts. Until next time.